outline at the end of the session. General Ray, may I request for you to please share your insights with our parent body. Thank you.
Very good afternoon to you, Preeti, and to our distinguished parents from grade 9 to grade 11 and the members of the faculty. It's a great privilege for me to be able to reach out to you, something which I would never have been able to do offline. And this is one of the big advantages online communication produces, that you can not only contact people, but you can touch the hearts of many more people than you would otherwise in a face-to-face situation there. So thank you very, very much for this opportunity. In my address to you this morning, I will focus on how the purpose of education at Indus is shaping our leadership philosophy, which in turn is preparing our child, your child, to succeed and be happy in a post-corona world. There are three big shifts that have happened. They started to happen 20 years back when we entered the fourth industrial revolution, driven by AI, machine learning, and bioengineering. But it took a corona to make us sit up, take note of these shifts, and hopefully start doing something about these shifts. But before that, I would like to place on record my very deep appreciation and gratitude to Preeti, the teachers of senior middle school and the diploma program, for what they have done. They are truly corona warriors. Doctors save lives in hospital. In these difficult times, these teachers are saving the future of our children. And the future where the only vaccine, there's only one vaccine, and that vaccine is innovation. Innovation is the only vaccine against COVID-19 and climate collapse. And this is why, without the effort that our teachers have put in, this would not have been possible. Online teaching, ladies and gentlemen, is no child's play. And the efforts which a teacher has got to make to switch from offline to online is huge. Much, much more than what you require in a physical space. And the reason is very simple. Teachers and schools that have been accustomed to teaching in brick and mortar schools, their methodology is linear. But when we go on to online, the methodology has to be primarily non-linear, because the plasma medium only fructifies in a non-linear medium. And I'll talk a little about this a little later. So I'd like to place on record for the great work these teachers are doing there. The purpose of education, as you know, to put it very succinctly, is to prepare your child for the future. But we have now recalibrated, refocused that into more specific outcomes. And I will talk to you about what this new leadership philosophy is, which is going to help us the way we work, the way we listen, the way we play, the way we innovate, the way we love, the way we think everything. The first shift that has taken place, and it took a corona to drive home this message, and this should have happened much, much earlier, maybe 30, 40, 50 years back. So far, education has focused on the head. In other words, it has focused on content. And now the situation has to focus on competencies of the heart and mind. So this is the big shift. Education of the heart and mind, and not the head alone. Therefore, teacher is more a teacher of competencies than content. Content is what AI can do better than anybody else. Google does an excellent job. So we are shifting from knowledge about, knowledge to do, and knowledge to be, to transform ourselves. Education must help us to be innovative. Education must help us to transform ourselves and transform society. Or the people who are responsible for us, we are responsible to. Our focus in education has been on economic man. To prepare children to do well in examinations, place them in good colleges, launch them on good career launch pads. This is all undergoing change. It has already happened, but now Corona is there to reinforce that outcome. Therefore, the role of a teacher now is no longer to teach the subject alone. The role of the teacher at Indus Pune is to teach the child and not the subject alone. To teach competencies, to provide emotional support, to provide personalized learning. To unlock the child's potential, to make the child become what she is capable of becoming. So this unlocking of potential is what the teacher is now going to be involved in. And she uses the subject she teaches as a medium to achieve these objectives. This is why in today's context, homeschooling is an outdated concept. Homeschooling is about teaching content. Homeschooling cannot teach competencies. To learn competencies, you've got to be part of a team. You've got to socialize. For example, if you have to develop empathy, you have to go out in the field and see people who are suffering. Or what the customer wants, if I call it customer empathy. You can't be sitting in a drawing room or a sitting room and hope that you're going to develop empathy. So you have to be connected to people, to teams, to networks, to develop these competencies. Ladies and gentlemen, talent no longer resides in individuals. Talent resides in the team. And therefore, if we want our children to be talented, which we all desire, she has to be part of a team. So homeschooling is a concept in the industrial age, but not definitely in the fourth industrial age, which is right. The second is a shift in leadership. All entrepreneurs are leaders, but most leaders are not entrepreneurs. Therefore, to be qualified to call yourself a leader, you have to be qualified to be an entrepreneur. So entrepreneur has got the innovative competencies like empathy, critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, grit, resilience, ability to handle failure, bounce back from failure, bounce higher than that, risk-taking. And she also has to have the competencies like marketing, sales, strategies for scaling up, selling the product, turning an idea into a reality, into a product. So those competencies she has to have. Therefore, the purpose of education at Indus, when your child graduates, she has to be future ready. And to be future ready, she has to be startup ready on day one. So even before the IB results are announced, she has to be startup ready. Our objective is that your child should give employment and not seek employment. to go into a startup after college is too late in today's world. The third shift, which we have seen, is in the online revolution. Online learning is not a substitute. It is an alternative. Blended learning is the way ahead of the future. Even if the skies were clear and there was no corona and we were back into La La Land, blended learning still has to be there. Online develops the non-linear side of our brain, the creative side of our brain. That is what the plasma medium does. Plasma medium is suited for the right side of the brain, for the non-linear part of the brain. The offline is better suited for the linear side, for the left side of the brain. To be innovative, you have to have the right balance between the right brain and the left. So blended learning is the new normal. Ladies and gentlemen, everything in corona, after corona, is going to change, even if you've got vaccines and drugs which are around the corner. But there are other threats which have already arrived. And the biggest threat which humanity faces us, right from the times dinosaurs got extinct, or asteroids started hitting the Earth and breaking it up as part of the Big Bang, is climate collapse. If the world's global temperatures go above 2 degrees Celsius, the situation, at least for the next 100 years, will be irreversible. Irreversible brain damage. Irreversible life damage will happen. Corona is a dress rehearsal. It's a mock-up test examination for the big examination, climate collapse, which is already at our doorstep. That is why everything will change. Despite vaccines, despite drugs, so the changes, the first change that will happen is that all future workplaces, which includes a home as a unit. The home is also a workplace where you live. Schools, colleges, companies, private sector, public sector, social sector, everywhere, wherever you work, are being turned into war zones. This is what I call is the Beirutization or Lebanization of society. Even Fortune 500 companies are now in a startup mode. Apple has no guarantee it will survive tomorrow. Neither has got Facebook. We have no idea what is going to happen tomorrow. It's not the black swan effect. It is not the butterfly effect. We have to understand that everything is going to change. Therefore, to parents, I say, and to teachers, I say, graduating students to be startup ready is more important than graduating them with 100 out of 100 or a 45 in the degree score there. I'm not against 45, but I'm against only 45 and nothing else. 45 without innovation is meaningless. It will not get you a job anywhere. And it will not prepare you for the next pandemics and the climate collapse, which is already started to happen. Therefore, the placement companies, the placement department in our schools should not only be looking at how to place your child in the best college or university. They should be looking at how to place your child as an apprentice in a startup company. We were in Israel very recently, in January. They practice kids, they are placed into the most elite units of their defense forces, because that is compulsory there. And after they do their stint there, they don't run to Harvard or Stanford. They're picked up with 7 and 8 figure salaries in the top companies of the world there. That is why they're the most innovative nation today. They are a startup country, the startup nation there. For every 2,000 people of the 8.5 million population, there is a startup company. Their whole country is in a startup mode. You go to the restaurants in the evening, you find these young couples there from the defense who are having dinner. They got their M16 automatic rifles on the table there. They go to the beach, the automatic rifles are in the lockers on the beach itself. They go to university, their automatics are in their university lockers there. The time they get the code word in 4 hours, they are into battle. They're firing their first shot into battle in 4 hours. That is a startup mode. We are on our toes. I'm reminded of the famous African proverb, the Swahili proverb. When the sun rises in Africa, the gazelles must run. If they don't run, the lions will eat them up. When the sun rises in Africa, the lions must also run. If they don't run, they will die of hunger. You look at the animals in the animal kingdom. Everybody is in a starter mode. They can be eaten up by any predator. That is what society has become. That is what I mean, startup ready. We are living in a tough neighborhood. Our mentality is that we got to be of a startup, ready to go into action immediately. So peacetime models, systems and processes are unworkable. The second big thing that is happening is the rate of obsolescence. It's absolutely awesome. Everything is getting obsolete. Knowledge, medicine, economy, politics, leadership, and even the role of a parent. The role of a parent in a post-corona world is different to what it was before. Though the common aspects remain the same, but the focus has changed now completely. Moore's law is outdated. It doesn't take now 24 months to double the computing power of a computer. Everything can change in 24 days, in 24 hours, in 24 minutes as I speak to you. Pareto's 20-80, the 20% is the critical few and 80 are the trivia, is invalid. That's a peacetime model. Mr. Pareto has to redefine it as 10-90. Only 10% things are critical in our life now when we are in a startup mode. 90% is trivia. We have to identify what is trivia and what is critical. Our students have got to identify what is critical in a subject and what is trivia.
Sir, I think your video has turned off. Could you please just check? Sorry to interrupt.
Is it all right now?
We still don't see you. Yes. Thank you. Sorry about that.
So the 2080 has got to be 1090 now. As parents, we have to identify what is that 10% critical in my life. Where 90% of my time will focus on that 10%. Students have got to reprioritize that this is 10%. This is where the teacher is going to help me out. 90% I'll do it on my own. We are seeing the collapse of standardization. Standardization is the biggest enemy of innovation. And we are experts in standardization. Asiatic societies are experts in standardization. Command control, titles, positions, hierarchies, silos. Have you ever thought that most of the critical decisions in our life have not been taken by us? They've been taken by parents, grandparents, peers, neighbors, neighbors, except ourselves. What to study, when to study, what college to go, what university to go, what school to go, what career to take up, when to marry, when to start a family. All critical decisions are being taken by somebody else. We are disempowered. So standardization, as I said, is the enemy of innovation. I look forward to the day when a PYP teacher could teach DP and a DP could teach a PYP. That is when I see the Berlin Wall in schools coming down. Right now, they're all siloed. And we become very defensive also. We don't like anybody to enter our territory. We're like tigers who mark their territory with urine and don't allow any other male tiger to enter. We are possessive. We are territorial. This doesn't work. In the innovative world, it doesn't work. We are part of teams, networks, and webs now. The fourth big impact, where parents play a very critical role, and schools play a critical role, where I see a great partnership between parents, teacher one, and teachers, teacher two, is building psychological immunity, especially in conditions of isolation, extreme, unabated ambiguity and uncertainty. Uncertainty keeps gnawing at your vitals. We have to get it over as quickly as possible. Fear of the contagion or another wave coming up there. Fear of fear itself. The biggest fear we face is fear. Our future, our business, our money, our relationships. Psychological immunity is one area, and collateral to that is cognitive immunity. You cannot have psychological immunity without cognitive immunity, or vice versa. Today, 70% of what you see on WhatsApp and social media and internet is fake news. It's disinformation. It is manipulation. It's people with agenda who are trying to influence our minds and confusing the whole situation, distorting reality. How do we train our children to distinguish between what is true and what is not true? They have to take decisions. And now it's very uncertain. It is not clear. Too much information, no information, little information, exaggerated information. That is the vacuum environment in where we are working in. Is this ethical? Is it unethical? Today, states and corporations have the ability to manipulate our thinking by hacking our brains. States and corporations, and they're doing it. Google knows more about you and me than you and I know about ourselves. Therefore, they can make us eat the cornflakes we like, the type of books we want to see, the Netflix films we want to see. They know your habit. They know your liking. So they'll show you exactly those things on the Netflix screen there. They can manipulate our thinking and our behavior. And And this is why, ladies and gentlemen, we are getting distracted and we are losing our memory. Today, there is a lot of evidence that people who are getting Alzheimer, Parkinson, and dementia are not the 70 plus. They are now the new normal now is 45, 50. 50 is now the new normal for Parkinson, Alzheimer, and dementia. Because we are cognitively weak. We have not trained our mind to be cognitively strong. How do we build up those cognitive antibodies in ourselves? For example, by deep reading. Deep reading helps you to build up cognitive immunity. Reflection, introspection, contemplation. These are exercises as part of our life to build up immunity, cognitive immunity. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to see Corona as something good that has happened, as something as a blessing that has happened to us. We were asleep so far. We were living in La La Land. We were living in a bubble, an illusion. We have to understand that Corona type situations will transform us into better human beings, into stronger human beings. It will make us more creative. And it will give us the ability to turn suffering into a triumph. Suffering ceases to be suffering the moment it finds meaning. The people who survived in Auschwitz and Dachau were not the strong and the young. They had something to live for, something to die for. And to live, you don't live for yourself, you live for others. To be happy is not being happy myself, it is to make other people happy. Apne liye to zindagi sabhi jeete hain. Sabhi jeete hain. Dusron ke liye jeena zindagi ka naam hai. How many of us are doing it? This is the mentality which children have to grow up with when they pass out from school. After school, it's payback time for a student. For parents who have been highly successful, and all of you are successful, you have to figure out your payback time. That is part of your 10-90. What is my payback time? Not just to my child, but to other child, other children. So this wartime leadership model which I am talking about is to have an entrepreneurial mind to be startup ready. What is Indus doing about it? From the next session onwards, we're going to start a startup school at Bangalore. It's an experiment. It has never been done in the world before. We're going to select 30 kids from Bangalore, 30 kids from Pune, and 30 kids from Hyderabad from grade 9 to 12. And along with the support, mostly of Indus parents, who are very successful entrepreneurs, you know, Bangalore is the startup capital of India. And Pune and Hyderabad are not far behind. Your children will be brought up by the best brains, best entrepreneurs, venture capitalists, angel investors, successful startup leaders. So by the time they graduate from grade 12, they are startup ready. As parents, that should be your concern, and not whether to send him to Stanford or Harvard or somewhere else. That will happen. If she can do a startup, Harvard will roll out a red carpet for her. Because they don't take people only on marks, they take people on performance. So 44 out of 45 may not get Harvard or Stanford. A 38 may get it. So hopefully I request that those who are listening to me, those who are entrepreneurs, as parents, please do write to me and to the principal that you would like to spare some time to help us run this entrepreneurship program for the children. I have no doubt it will succeed. I have no doubt about it. And with 1 year's experiment, we will raise it to 100 each. So there will be 100 kids in Pune, 100 in Hyderabad, 100 in Bangalore in year two who will be in the startup race. And lastly is the role of the teacher. It's no longer to teach the subject alone. A primary role is to teach the child. That is our 10%. Our 90% is the subject part, 10% is the child. Today a teacher, the world over, has no time for the child. We are fooling ourselves, deluding ourselves to think it is happening. 90% of a teacher's time is spent in preparing for at least 4 lessons next day. I'd like to know in which profession of the world today, a day before or 2 days before, you are preparing for your job the next day, 4 big events next day, every day, 365. Then she has homework assignments, she has got formative assessments, summative assessments. She has to organize the rigor process like support classes, like clustering, like revision, personalizing learning. Then she has house day and Indus day and sports day and this day and that day. She has no time. So what we have done successfully in Bangalore, we have made the world's first robots. And we are going into collaboration with some of the finest AI scientists in Israel. In fact, tomorrow I have my final round meeting with them. The robots take over, that means AI takes over 90% of what is routine and repetitive and mundane. So the teacher now has got 90% of her time to spend on your child. A teacher who otherwise did not spend any time with the child, now 90% of her time is going to be spent with the child. To develop her entrepreneurial competencies, to make her a better human being, to make her more ethical. So we are sending 5 robots to Pune in the next session. Since we are making them ourselves, it takes a little time, and because of this international travel and corona, etc., a lot of things have got delayed. But by the end of the session, there will be 5 robots in Pune. So now you can expect your teachers, our teachers, spending much, much more time with your child than ever before. Or any teacher in the world, more than any teacher in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to look at Corona as Mother Nature's blessing to us. It is a blessing because man is genetically connected to nature, but because of our lifestyle, we have become disconnected. Man started off his journey to become a Homo sapien from a water molecule. We were born in nature. We are dependent on everything in nature, on air, on food, on water, on oxygen. We are dependent on Mother Nature. We took it for granted. Therefore, we should look at COVID-19 as a great reminder that we need to integrate ourselves with nature. We have to look at COVID-19 as a crucible experience, as a life-altering experience. That must transform us. The most powerful medium to be innovative is to go through a crucible experience. Like Mahatma Gandhi when he was thrown out of the train. That was a crucible experience. That's when non-violence was born. This philosophy of non-violence. I would like you to see Corona, as I said, as a blessing. I would like you to see innovation as the only vaccine against COVID-19. I would like you to see innovation as the only vaccine against climate collapse. I would like you to see innovation as the only method of developing cognitive and psychological antibodies in us. Corona has given us a lot of time to reconnect with ourselves. Again, we had lost track of ourselves. Who we are, why we are here, where are we going. हम अपने आप से पराए हो गए थे. We were alienated from ourselves. I still maintain that Facebook is a cry for loneliness. Excessive use of Facebook is a cry for loneliness. Only lonely people on lonely planets are hooked onto social media. And therefore we had lost our self-esteem. Therefore, this is a pause button. It's the recenter button on your GPS map. It is a reminder that I am the most important person in my life. Because when I change, the world around me will change. Because I have to transform myself first before I start transforming other people. Because I think, therefore I am. Go to the plane, the air hostess announces that if there's a drop in pressure, cabin pressure, the masks will drop. First put the mask on yourself and then onto your child thereafter. You can only put the mask on your child provided you are in a position to do so. I would like you to remind you of the Matrix film. 1999 Matrix, where Morpheus, the internet rebel, offers the red pill and the blue pill to Neo, the man who is struggling to find meaning in his life. He says, you take the blue pill and you continue to remain in your bubble, in a world of illusion. Whereas Osho in Koregaon Park was very fond of saying, Somnambulist. Chances are there. Nidra or Ninda. You take the red pill and you break out of this cocoon, this falsehood, and take the world, take the reality of the world head on. Take the bull by the horns. Take responsibility for your own future, your own destiny. COVID-19 now is offering us this choice. Those who take the blue pill, their fate is questionable.
Give me 5-10 minutes. I'm just
school.
My son's school actually.
Those who take the red pill are those who will survive, who will help others to survive.
I'll give you a call in. Let's say
will be happy and will make others. We have worked out a very elaborate back to school plan. We don't know when school is going to start. It's a guesstimate. We are not oracles. We don't have clairvoyance. But from going by what the HRD ministry is talking about, what chief ministers are talking about, it is definitely unlikely to happen before September. And the decision to open the schools will not be political or economic. It will be based on big data. It will be based on the advice given by doctors and immunologists. Because rightly, no country, no society can take a chance with children. You can take a chance anywhere else. You can't take a chance with children. If that happens, it will be a collective failure on our part. But as and when the green flag is raised, we should be ready with protocols and infrastructures which will ensure that your child is safer on the campus than at home or anywhere else in the world. That will ensure that the borders, particularly the borders, are safest. Because they will be under adult supervision. There will be everybody on the campus, including the borders, under the watchful eyes of teachers and adults, doctors and nurses. And this plan has been worked out in collaboration with Apollo Hospitals for all our three schools and all our early learning centers. Their doctors and nurses will be there to ensure that we follow the protocols. And we are not charging any money for it. It's very expensive. It starts by having a full-time resident doctor. We just have a doctor for Pune. Nursing staff, additional nursing staff. And a lot of the equipment, like thermal temperature scanners, like automatic sanitizers, like isolation ward, bays. And we're doing it at no extra expense. We're not asking the parents to pay for it. We feel this is our obligation. We're obliged to do it. So, our principal, Preeti Prabhu, will discuss this plan with you, and hopefully by the end of this month, we will sign on to it. And then a written document will be given to each parent. Signed on both by Apollo and us. I'll be delighted to take any questions you have, any suggestions you have, any comments you have. I'd like Indian parents or entrepreneurs to come forward and offer their services as payback time to help our children become what they should be and what they can be. Preeti?
Thank you, Jasmine.